Good morning. I'm Sunita Vishwanath, co-founder of Hindus for Human Rights. Thank you for inviting me to be with you today. I'm sorry not to be with you in person, but I'm honored to send you my remarks. I'm sure that Professor Manoj Chatterjee and Professor Dibyesh Anand would have given you a detailed, alarming, but true picture of the deterioration of democracy and human rights in India today. I will not give you yet another long list of the atrocities taking place in Modi's India, atrocities towards Muslims, Christians, Sikhs, Dalits, and anyone raising their voice in dissent. I will not tell you that Tripura is burning with the fires of anti-Muslim mob violence, and this in retaliation for the fires of anti-Hindu mob violence across the border in Bangladesh. I will not tell you that some Indians have been thrown into jail just for tweeting Tripura is burning, and that the Indian police has asked Twitter to suspend 68 accounts which have tweeted about Tripura, citing India's draconian anti-terror law, the Unlawful Acts Prevention Act, including our own close US-based partner organization, Indian American Muslim Council. You know all this already. I won't tell you about the hundreds of pro-democracy activists, students, journalists, protesters against the anti-Muslim citizenship law, the CAA, who have been in jail for months, if not years, even though there is no evidence of any crime they have committed. I won't tell you about Father Stan Swamy, one of India's brave political prisoners jailed on preposterous fabricated charges of terrorism and sedition, an 84-year-old Jesuit priest with Parkinson's disease, whose entire life was dedicated to serving India's marginalized indigenous communities, who died in state custody in July. You have already wept for Father Stan. And I won't tell you that all these atrocities are taking place under the authoritarian Hindu nationalist regime of Narendra Modi and the BJP and RSS, whose clear and explicitly stated goal is to turn India from a secular democracy into a Hindu Rashtra. You know this too, and hardly need reminding. What I will tell you is that 10 years ago, I started on this path of building a progressive Hindu platform, which stands resolutely against caste and Hindu nationalism, and which is unwaveringly committed to justice and human rights of all people on earth and to protecting our planet. The most important thing that needs to happen to save Indian democracy is that its majority population, the Hindu population, needs to wake up and see what is happening. Hindus need to understand that the increasingly frequent newspaper headlines in international media that point out the hatred, the Islamophobia, the violence, the denial of constitutional rights, including freedom of expression, the lynchings and rapes of minorities, that these are not disinformation, these are not fake news. This is the reality of today's India. My Hindu community in India and the diaspora needs to realize that the country India is headed in a dark and dangerous direction that will be as bad for Hindus as it will be for anyone else. Because when democracy dies, everyone suffers. It was recently the Hindu holy festival of Deepavali or Diwali, when we celebrate the victory of good over evil. My prayer, this and every Diwali in recent memory, is for my Hindu community to come to its senses and for the juggernaut of Hindutva, of hateful Hindu nationalism, to be rejected, defeated, slain. My prayer is for my Hindu kith and kin to remember what they have clearly forgotten, that our religion teaches us that we are all one, that the ideal devotee sees the joys and sorrows of another as our own, sees God in the face of every person, regardless of their caste, religion, race, gender, class, and that our ultimate dharma as Hindus is loka sangraha, the well-being of all. We have lost our way, mired in hate, violence, and a manufactured sense of victimhood, which conveniently justifies it all. This Diwali, I prayed hard for a return to sanity in India and in the Indian diaspora, a return to democratic and pluralistic values, rule of law, and protection of minorities. Many of us in Hindus for Human Rights went to community and family Diwali functions and gatherings. Diwali greetings were exchanged in our family and community WhatsApp and Telegram groups. What we realized this Diwali is that in our Hindu spaces, people have still not woken up to the horror that is underway in India. While Time magazine proclaimed that India is on its way to an anti-Muslim genocide, Diwali was celebrated in our family and community spaces as if absolutely nothing's wrong, with no acknowledgement of the crisis, with no prayer for peace. This Diwali, it dawned on me that we will need to ready ourselves for a fight that may take decades rather than years, and things may get worse before they get any better. We know that the Hindu right is growing in power and reach here in the United States. Our colleagues in the UK, Europe, South Africa, Australia, New Zealand, they tell us that the same is happening in their countries as well. All of us in our coalitions of pro-democracy organizations and advocates are working incredibly hard to raise global awareness of the crisis of democracy in India. And we must continue our efforts, undaunted by the public shaming and trolling, the personal attacks and threats, and even lawsuits. Even if we are the side with few numbers, we must be strong in our conviction and speak for pluralism, peace, and the rights and the safety of minorities. And even if there are risks, we in the diaspora must use our voice to boldly raise awareness of the plight of India's Muslims and other minorities. When one of us is attacked, we have all been attacked. We must unite as one to defend each other. We must also speak up for the oppressed minorities in other countries in South Asia. It was extremely heartening to see so many non-Hindu groups speak up against the mob violence against Hindus that took place in Bangladesh recently. Many of you know that my colleague Raju and I are among those who have been sued by a Hindutva-aligned organization, the Hindu American Foundation. It is very telling that the group that has been sued consists of two Hindus, a Muslim, a Christian, and a scholar. They have attacked exactly what we are fighting to save, the secular fabric of India. I believe in my core that the best thing we can do to fight this force of hate and division is to cling together and refuse to be divided. Muslim, Hindu, Christian, Sikh, Dalit, atheist, scholar, student, teacher, all of us united in our glorious diversity and our commitment to an India and a world where the rights of each one of us is sacrosanct.